welcome to our worship service, inside, outside, and online. It is our hope that you find inspiration and joy in your time with us. The announcements, including our contact information, is on the last page of this bulletin. And we hope that if you're just joining us for the first time, you'll worship with us again soon. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who journeys with us these 40 days and sustains us with the gift of grace. Amen. Let us acknowledge before God and one another our need for repentance and God's mercy. Holy God, we confess to you our faults and failings. Too often we neglect and do not trust your holy word. We take for ourselves instead of giving to others. We spoil rather than steward your creation. We cause hurt when you call us to heal. We choose fear over compassion. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us as we seek to follow in your way of life. Amen. Hear the good news. God so loved the world that God gave his only Son, so that all may receive life. This promise is for you. God embraces you with divine mercy and forgives you in Christ's name and revives you in the Spirit's power. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
We'll read the Kyrie responsibly. In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world and for the well-being of the Church of God and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, your Son came into the world to free us all from sin and death. Breathe upon us the power of your Spirit, that we may be raised to new life in Christ and to serve you in righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Sin is on.
is real weak in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, with the Lord there is plenteous redemption.
The Lord shall redeem Israel from all our sins.
The second reading is from Romans chapter 8. To set the mind of the flesh is death, but to set the mind of the spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the spirit, since the spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the spirit is life because of righteousness. The spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. He who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through the spirit that dwells in you. So it is for me. Accordingly, though Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus, after her hearing that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. After that, he said to his disciples, "Let us go to Judea again." The disciples said to him, "Rabbi, the Jews were just now trying to stone you, and are you going there again?" Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Those who walk during the day do not stumble because they see the light of this world. But those who walk at night stumble because the light is not in them." After saying this, he said to them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to awaken him." The disciples said to him, "Lord, if he has fallen asleep, he will be all right." Jesus, however, had been speaking about his death, but they thought he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe. But let us go to him." Thomas, who was called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, "Let us also go, that we may die with him." When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to Jesus, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha said to him, "I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this?" She said to him, "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world." When she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary and told her privately, "The teacher is here and is calling for you." And when she heard it, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. The Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary get up quickly and go out. They followed her because they thought she was going to the tomb to weep there. When Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt at his feet and said to him, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and moved, deeply moved. He said, "Where have you laid him?" They said to him, "Lord, come and see." Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. Jesus said, "Take away the stone." Martha said of the dead man, said to him, "Lord, already there is a stench because he has been dead for 4 days. Jesus said to her, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you would see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone, and Jesus looked upward and said, "Father, I thank you for hearing me, for having heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I have said this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that we may believe that you sent me." When he had said this, he cried out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out." The dead man came out. His hands and feet were bound with the strips of cloth, and his face was wrapped in cloth. And Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." Many of the Jews, therefore, who had been with Mary and had seen what Jesus did, believed in him. The end of the gospel lesson. Do you have any kids, children, who would like to come up for a children's sermon? Sometimes you don't think he's listening, right? You don't think he's hearing you. You're asking for something, and he's not answering.
He's like, "No."
Okay. So what do you think this is? What does this look like? A cookie. Is it baked or what? Not baked. It's a piece of wall dough. Doesn't look real appetizing, does it? Would you want to eat this one? Okay. Well, let's pretend this cookie would talk. And if I said to this cookie, "I'm going to put you in a hot oven, and I'm going to cook you," what do you think this cookie might say? "Don't cook me, that's right." But if I put that blob in the hot oven, it turns into these.
cooking makes it better in the end, right? So sometimes when we're talking to God and we don't think he's listening to us, he's actually doing things behind the scenes that make us better. God is always working in our lives, and we don't always understand how or why. And we don't always know what's coming up. In the Bible, there's a story about Lazarus, as you're hearing as I read. He was a friend of Jesus, and he had two sisters who were also friends of Jesus. But Lazarus got really sick. And his sisters asked Jesus to come and make him well and make him better. But he didn't. So Lazarus died, and they were very sad. But Jesus was really sad, too. To trust God. And that's what we have to do. So, you want to hold your hands and say a prayer with me? Dear God, thank you for your promises. We know that your words are true. Even though we don't always understand your ways, you tell us things that will work for good. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your love. We love you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, well, you can each take a pack of cookies, but you can only
eat them when your parents tell you that. The work of God's Spirit gives hope of new life in Paul's letter to the Church of Rome. The gospel gives us encouraging words to sustain us through the approaching despair of Christ's passion and brings us to the fulfillment of hope on Easter. Let's look at the hope of our gospel reading in more detail. The Gospel of John tells us the hope-filled story of raising of Lazarus from the dead. In the dramatic scene, Jesus calls his friend out of the tomb and restores him to life. Jesus not only brings new life to Lazarus, but he also brings new life to Lazarus' sisters and the community, and to us today. Our gospel lesson today encourages faith and hope. How?
While the people knew Lazarus was dead, by bringing him back to life,
both the disciples and the people would know that Jesus was the Savior.
When Jesus wanted to return to Bethany, his disciples wondered why, because the Jews had just tried to stone him. And Lazarus had also been dead for several days, so why would he go back there? But Jesus said Lazarus was a dear friend to him and his sisters, and he did that in order to motivate the disciples to accompany him to witness to this. Jesus wept. It's in this lesson. It's the shortest verse in the Bible. And it showed that Jesus truly grieved Lazarus' death and the pain that it caused Mary and Martha. How do Christians experience unfulfilled hope? This is a challenge because of Israel's woes were not all at the end, and they continue today. Other songs tell the struggle and pain that Christ believers at Rome were persecuted, and Jesus, who raised Lazarus from the dead, soon dies himself. And yet hope is fulfilled as Paul proclaims, all Israel will be saved. Psalm 46 sings of God's presence in time of trouble. A preview of the hope of the resurrection will sustain believers in these final days of Lent. The bottom line? It's the Christian's confidence in the resurrection of the dead that epitomizes our hope in Christ. The raising of Lazarus was a big sign that Jesus was the Son of God. How else could he perform this miracle of bringing back someone to life, as we know it? The resurrection that we receive through Christ is a new life and part of our future. Although many people wish that their loved ones would return like Lazarus from the grave, we know that that doesn't happen. However, we also know that death does not have the last word. Though the one who is in the resurrection and the life, we have promises of new life, even though we don't know what that new life will look like. The raising of Lazarus can give us comfort because Jesus is stronger than death. Resurrection does not deny that death happened. Rather, it promises that death is not the end and that God can still bring new life. By bringing Lazarus back to life, Jesus proved that if we believe in him, we will have life even when we die. Because we believe in Jesus, we will live with him forever in heaven, even though our physical bodies are dead. By bringing back Lazarus' physical body was a sign to us that we will have life eternal. Even when life scares us, Jesus calls us by name and asks us to come out of our anxiety, our pain, and our despair. Hear his voice and celebrate the life that God gives. We are not a people of fear, but of hope. And that's the hope of the gospel that we need to cling to in the face of despair, even in the face of death. It's the hope that we share at funerals. But let's not wait for that. We need to share this hope we have in Christ today with all of those around us. Amen. We'll continue with the hymn. us confess our faith and with the words of the creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Sustained by God's abundant mercy, let us pray for the church, the world, and all creation.
Hear us when we call to you. Deliver us from the depths of our despair and free us from the worries that bind us. Merciful God, your spirit of life dwells in our assembly. Bless the music ministers of this congregation and all who lead us in hymns of praise and in songs of lament and prayer. Merciful God, who by the resurrection of life, even though we die, we will live. With thanksgiving, we remember all your saints who now live in your eternal love. Merciful God,
receive our prayer.
We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew your whole creation through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. You call your people to cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, that renewed in this day of baptism, we may come to the fullness of your grace. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
If you don't have your communion kit, they're on the back table back there. If not, you can get them out. They've already been consecrated.
When our congregation gathered for the celebration of Holy Communion, we heard again the story of God's mighty acts and of the love shown us in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. With thanksgiving, we remember that in the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and gave it thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying,
This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you, for all people, and for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. We were given assurance of our Lord's presence through this gift of his Holy Spirit. Now the same bread of life and the same cup of blessing is given to you, that you may be strengthened through your participation in the body of Christ. Amen. Our Father, let us continue with worship. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation,
but deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
and the power,
and the glory,
forever and ever.
Amen. Come and receive Jesus, our strength in the wilderness. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us and grant us peace.
And now the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, given and shed for you. You may not consume the communion or take it home to communion later. God, the giver of love, Christ, the resurrection and the life, and the Holy Spirit of rebirth, bless you in this Lenten journey. Continue with the next hymn. Go in peace, serve in love.